Belinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of Piccolo and Annabelle, Volume 4, The Steamer Demons, written by Stephen Axelsen and read by Stanley McGeagh. The dedication reads, For Julie Catherine, dairy farmer's daughter, painter, and my mother. Thank you to all the English authors and illustrators who have provided me with inspiration over recent decades, and all the English folk I know personally for being so very pleasant, and Heather for her first-hand knowledge of zoos. Prologue. Piccolo Grand ran along the garden path, through the grove of lily-pillies, and skidded on his knees to the edge of the pond.
Mum, Dad, are you still alive?
Two silvery perch swam to greet him, their eyes wide with relief.
Oh, you're all right. I'm sorry, it's been a whole week.
The boy broke off a piece of banana cake and threw it to his pets.
I've been so busy cleaning and cooking and looking after Annabelle, I think there's something wrong with her.
Annabelle was Piccolo's great aunt, except that she wasn't. She was his guardian angel. A loud, messy, and affectionate creature, the opposite of Piccolo in every way. 2.5 years ago, Piccolo's parents had disappeared at sea, so he had lived alone in his home, Holywell, and waited for their return. But his quiet, tidy life had been rudely disturbed. Annabelle had bounced in, uninvited, to look after him. The odd couple learned to live happily enough together, and Piccolo learned to keep his big secret. Annabelle had discovered that her boy was a special one. He was more than just a tidy, sock-ironing, list-making boy. Piccolo Grand was an angel spotter. He could see angels, invisible or disguised. But if Annabelle's inspector of guardian angels found out, Piccolo would be marched off to Angel Spotters Academy, or, and much worse, if the forces of darkness guessed his secret, he'd be hunted down by demons to be put to work for evil ends. There had been some near misses and alarming adventures, but more recently, times had been pleasantly dull and ordinary. So ordinary that Piccolo's lively guardian had become bored and moody.
She needs some excitement,
Piccolo explained to Mum and Dad Perch.
But I don't. I like things nice and calm. I'd be happy if nothing exciting ever happened again.
The Perch nibbled a soggy cake and bobbed in agreement. Now carry on listening and hope that nothing happens, for Piccolo's sake. Chapter 1. The Tramp and the Princess.
I'm not sure I love the smell of fish, said Piccolo Grand to the dog beside him. Not tons of it, anyway. I feel a bit queasy.
But Busstop wasn't listening. He had found something to bark at.
Arf!
He said.
Arf?
Asked Piccolo.
Oh, yes, I see. Smoke.
They peered together at a plume of dark smoke out to sea. Piccolo and Busstop rocked gently atop the mast of Old Gammel, a fishing boat belonging to Young Gammel, who sorted his catch, tons of fish, on the deck below them.
We can see smoke,
Piccolo called down to his new friend.
Ah, good. That'll be her,
Young Gammel predicted. Young Gammel, at nearly 80 years of age, was 1 year younger than his boat.
You two hang on up there, right? It's a long way down to the deck, see?
Piccolo had taken to visiting the docks a lot lately, asking curious questions of sailors and seamen.
Have you seen a yacht, the Leaping Susan, or a bunch of sea gypsies? They look like bikies with beards and big tummies.
The Leaping Susan was Piccolo's parents' yacht, missing since it sailed into a mysterious mist somewhere on the great ocean. His parents were still missing along with it. Piccolo had known the sea gypsies when they were the Stinky Cheese Gypsies, a cheese-loving motorcycle gang. They had gone to sea hunting. But no one he spoke to had seen the yacht, his parents, or the bearded gypsies.
"It's very smoky smoke," Piccolo decided from his lookout. "It doesn't look like sea princessy sort of smoke."
Bus Stop and Piccolo were waiting for his friend Stella. She was due to arrive home from her holiday cruise on the glittering sea princess. Piccolo had missed her. She was tall, capable, easygoing. And for reasons Piccolo could not imagine, she seemed to like him. A lot. Bus Stop scowled at the smoke and growled a little.
"Perhaps it's having engine trouble, like Annabelle's bike."
Piccolo's great-aunt Annabelle had decided not to join Piccolo at the dock.
"You go, dear," she'd said. "Stella is your friend, and there's something wrong with the motorbike."
At Holywell, Annabelle, Piccolo's unhappy guardian angel, sat on the ottoman, a great square flat couch covered in comfy cushions. She chewed a piece of fudge, banana-flavoured, and sighed and tried to read a book. There was nothing wrong with her motorbike. She was just too miserable to join a happy homecoming at the dock. There simply wasn't enough for a high-spirited and bustling guardian angel to do.
"Bored, bored, bored," she sighed.
Piccolo was so capable, so sensible, and so five other kinds of ubbles, that he hardly needed a guardian angel. Also, Annabelle's inspector had made her give up her hobby, winning things. He was a stern little angel who said that her hobby was causing suspicion, which was true, and envy. He was right about that, too. There was another thing on her list of miseries. She missed Dave, leader of the Stinky Cheese Gypsies. Nice guy and ace demon-hunting angel. He had gone away to sea, hunting. The smoky plume led a ship around the headland and into Clearwater Bay. Bus Stop's growling grew louder.
"We can see a ship now, but we don't think it's the Sea Princess,"
Piccolo called to young Gamble.
"There's some black clouds following it."
"Hang on, matey. I'm coming with me spyglass."
Gamble left his fish, wiped his hands briefly, and clambered up the mast like a 9-year-old.
"Here you go."
Piccolo took the scaly telescope and focused on the ship.
"Ugh!
That's not any kind of princess. It's filthy."
He handed it to Gamble for a look.
"I've seen some unsightly tubs in my time. Even sailed a few. But that steamer's a stinker,"
he croaked.
"Well, those dead fishies aren't sorting themselves, and that's foul weather coming."
He slid down to the deck. Piccolo held the spyglass for Bus Stop, who growled deep in his throat. A cold chill spread over Piccolo as the ship steamed closer. Bus Stop shivered too. They could hear the thud and clank of its ancient engine now. Two tugboats waiting for the Sea Princess chugged out of its way. Soot from its crooked smokestack enveloped the watches.
"Looks like it's just rust held together with a bit of paint,"
Piccolo coughed.
"And it's got more patches than Gamble's pants. Let's go and have a look."
The boy and his dog climbed down from old Gamble's mast and explained their plan to young Gamble.
"You take a care, young fellas. There's something mighty rum about that tub,"
he said, pointing a halibut in its direction. The young fellas jogged and trotted carefully towards the harbour master's office at the far end of the dock. The harbour master, Captain H. Hummingway, was in charge of all comings and goings of craft in the bay. He sat in his office at his tidy desk, humming happily. A dignified man in a smart blue uniform, he was particularly pleased and excited to have the beautiful Sea Princess coming to his dock. Through his office window, he watched the sunlight glinting on the water and little jolly welcome flags fluttering. The big welcome banner swayed gently in the breeze. The dock workers stood by their posts. The Clearwater Bay Primary School brass band popped and gurgled into readiness. The captain returned to the speech he was writing for the occasion.
It is a great privilege, no, an honour, to welcome such a splendid, no, magnificent,
A dark shadow fell across his desk. Captain Hemingway looked up. What he saw horrified him. Piccolo and Bustop arrived to see the harbourmaster bursting through his door. He waved an arm frantically and yelled into a loud hailer,
No! 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 Belay! Begone! Get away! You can't dock here!
But the steamer came closer and closer. With it came a cold, squally gust of wind and the first sheets of rain. The brass band scattered. The wind whipped away the Welcome Sea Princess, Jewel of the Ocean banner. The steamer's old engine strained in reverse to slow the ship down, but it ground heavily into the dock. Timbers split and creaked. The ship's horn blasted cheekily, and dock workers ran to join the scattered brass band. Sailors dropped two heavy ropes over the side of the ship. A gangplank crashed onto the dock, and two sailors scuttled down, tying the ropes to bollards on the dock.
The Sea Princess is berthing here! Get this rust bucket out of here!
The harbour master screamed. The two seedy-looking sailors, one thick and the other thin, sauntered over to the emotional man. They were dressed to match their vessel, in oily overalls and sweaters stained with rust. Piccolo sheltered under the eaves of the harbour master's office. A drenched tuba player and bass drummer were already there, confused and trembling. Bustop backed up next to Piccolo's legs, growling softly.
Oh, the Sea Princess, said a skinny sailor. The Sea Princess is berthing here, he hissed, mimicking the harbour master with sticky sarcasm. We must be gone henceforth, Hubert.
He called our scabby tramp a rust bucket, Egbert, said Hubert the fat one. A rust bucket? I am offended. Boo-hoo.
He sniffed and blew into an oily rag.
Now look what you've done, cried Egbert, advancing menacingly on poor Captain Hemingway. You have offended Hubert, he snarled, poking the man hard in the chest. So I think we'll be staying, poking him through the office door, for as long as we like.
He slammed the door and caught sight of Piccolo and Bustop.
What are you lot looking at? He sneered, and turned back to the ship, cackling nastily.
Hubert the fat sailor suddenly shouted,
Is that a tuba I see lurking in the shadows? Come out here, you, and play us a tune.
Piccolo almost felt sorry for Brian Pomeroy, the tuba player, as a bass drummer shoved him out into the rain. Brian was Piccolo's least favourite schoolmate.
Give us down among the dead men, bellowed the sailor.
They didn't teach us that,
stuttered Brian.
I want the jig. Play me a jig now, or I'll swab the dock with you.
Brian honked and parped a shaky tune, and Hubert weaselly danced his jig, splashing in the rain. Several other sailors at the ship's railing clapped and whooped. Piccolo watched this ridiculous pantomime, feeling very uncomfortable. Then he froze. For an instant, the fat, jigging sailor had changed. The brown, lined face and scraggly beard had turned green and leathery. The grinning yellow teeth had sharpened into needle points. Piccolo turned away from the eyes, which had blazed red.
Demon,
he breathed. Swallowing hard, he picked up Bustop.
That's a demon,
he shuddered.
Maybe they're all demons.
Bustop gave the pale boy a comforting lick on the cheek, then gave himself.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.